Right. Hi, everybody. I think I forgot to mention this at the last lecture. Before I give you today's lecture, let me mention that there is an applet you can use, which is linked from the class web page. It's somewhere on my web page, which draws these playback graphs for you. So you can see here I have a playback graph. And in general, we have the face labels, which you can see by pressing draw sets, and then you can click the green sets, and then this way you're gonna apply square moves. So that's one thing you can do. You can also draw the strands, which you can see the orange strand label 3 goes from vertically from the bottom to top, and then all the faces to the left of it contain 3. All face labels to the right do not contain 3. So you can kind of, instead of, at some point I just got tired drawing this with my hands, and I didn't have an iPad back then, so it's a fast way to if you play with it, it's at some point you realize that you can easily answer questions of like whether something is, what's the minimal number of square moves to get from one place to the other, and etc. And so you have these buttons on the right, which basically allow you to choose different n and k, and that's going to be for the top cell. So 4 choose 2, 5 choose 2, 6 choose 3, and there's also, if you are not satisfied with the top cell, you can basically here on the left, you can plug in an arbitrary collection of faces, and it's going to give you a playback graph. So let's say I can, for example, remove 1, 5, 6, and hopefully it works. And then just press the arrows. Yeah, so see, 1, 5, 6 is removed, and now I get a smaller playback graph, and etc. So yeah, if you input a weakly separated, if you input a collection of playback graph faces on the left, and then it's going to draw a playback graph for you, and then you can apply the square move as you would normally do. Yes. So I encourage everybody to go play with the applet. Let me know if it does not work properly. It's been a few years since I looked at that code the last time. Anyways, let me now go back to the So this lecture is also going to be very kind of combinatorial before I go to the cluster algebras part. So what did we have? We had a bounded affine permutation F. Bounded affine permutation, which is some bijection from Z to Z. And then we also had the sequence I sub F, which consists of these I1, I2, etc. I sub n, that's the Grassmann necklace, which you can, right, so these are the boundary, faces. I can't really point to this picture, but they are, yeah, and the boundary in this picture. And this Grassmann necklace, you can use it to describe the positroid of your bounded affine permutation. So just by definition, the positroid is, it consists of all k element sets which are larger than I sub R in the shifted Gale order for all R in N. Right, so that is this order is the R shifted, it's the Gale order shifted by R. And the Gale order is just the term-wise order on K element sets. Okay, so you can use the positroid. The positroid tells you which minors are strictly positive and which are zero in the corresponding positroid cell. Now, let me mention there is a pretty interesting property of these positroids and things like that, which is called the purity phenomenon. So So let me mention the first example of a purity phenomenon, which may not look surprising to you. So what I claim is that any maximal by inclusion collection of pairwise non-intersecting diagonals. So I'm talking about diagonals of an n-gon. Diagonals. Well, first of all, it is also maximal by size, and it gives a triangulation. This is an obvious claim. It sounds very stupid, right? You draw a polygon, and then you choose maybe one diagonal, and then you choose some other diagonal that does not cross the first one, and then you're stuck. So what you get is a triangulation, and any two triangulations have the same number of diagonals in them. All right, so is there a generalization? Is there a generalization? Well, how do you even generalize? Well, first of all, we know that the triangulations correspond to the case of, this is the case of Grassmannian 2, n. So what about generalization for k higher than 2? Is there any statement which looks like this for higher k? And the answer is yes. And even before I tell you the statement, let me tell you a similar looking statement, which, however, is not related to Grassmannians. Well, not, it's related to the wiring diagrams that we studied previously. So it's all cluster algebraic, very much so. So let me give you a definition. Two sets. So let's say I take two sets I and j, just arbitrary subsets of n, not necessarily of the same size, arbitrary size. Let me say that they are called strongly separated. Wait, why is it? Yeah, okay. So they are called strongly separated. If there is no A less than B less than C, so there is no triple of indices A, B, C, such that A and C belong to I minus J, and B belongs to J minus I, or vice versa. So it's a symmetric notion. And I say that they are strongly separated if there is no such triple. So in other words, there should be a way, if you consider the numbers 1, 2, all the way up to n, and then you circle all elements of I minus j, then there should be a vertical line that separates them from all elements of j minus I. Kind of, they can be either, I minus j should be either completely to the left of all elements of j minus I, or completely to the right of all elements j minus I. So that's the notion. And let me try to come up here's another definition. So by a collection, I'm gonna mean just a set of sets. To be less confusing, instead of saying set of sets, I'm gonna say collection of sets. And a collection, let's say W So I'm going to consider a collection of sets, two to the bracket n denotes all possible sets, and such a collection is called strongly separated if any two elements of this collection are strongly separated. And well, also W is called maximal by size. Well, let's first say maximal by inclusion if it is not properly contained inside any other strongly separated collection. And well, and also let me say that this is maximal by inclusion, and I can also say that it's maximal by size if it has maximal size, if it has the maximal possible size among all strongly separated collections inside 2 to the brackets n. So I fix n and I ask either how do I find collections which are maximal by size, or I can ask, well, take one set, take another set, and keep adding sets until you get stuck. And that is called maximal by inclusion. So for example, maybe I should, first of all, let me mention which sets are strongly separated from everything. You can pause the video and think about it. What are the sets which are strongly separated from all other sets? Well, the claim is that they look like this. There is the empty set 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, all the way up to n, right? And there is also the kind of the initial intervals. But there is also the complements of initial intervals, right? There is also sets of the form r, r plus 1, etc. up to n. Right, it's very easy to see from this definition here that whenever you take I minus j, if I is one of these sets, then basically I minus j is going to be always to the left of j minus I in this case, and to the right in this case. So they're always going to be strongly separated. So in particular, let's look at some examples. Let's say n is equal to 3. So the intervals are, well, these, let me call these intervals, these sets here are called intervals. They are the empty set 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 3, and that's it. So the only two sets which are left, the only sets left are 1, 3, and And so the maximal strongly separated collections, the maximal, let's say, by inclusion, are, well, each collection is, you take all intervals plus 1, 3, or you take on all intervals plus 2. And these are the only two collections, and they all have the same size. Each of them has size 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Each has size 7. Okay, so these are also maximal, not only by inclusion, but by size, right? No matter how you add up these elements, you end up with the same size, which is 7. Okay, now let's try. So there was a problem with the original pre-recorded lecture because the iPad screen got stuck in the middle for like 20 minutes. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna re-record the 20 minutes part, and then I'm gonna insert it into the original lecture using my amazing video editing skills. So there's gonna be a seamless transition about 20 minutes from now. Okay, so what I'm gonna try now is I'm gonna explain how to, I'm gonna explain what happens to the strong separation examples when n is equal to 4. And when n is equal to 4, like previously, so my intervals again, are gonna be just all initial or terminal intervals. Intervals, empty set, 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, and 4. Okay, so these are the intervals, and then my maximal strongly separated collection is going to contain all the intervals, because they are strongly separated from everything, plus some other collection of sets, which I'm gonna randomly choose to be. I mean, you can try to add, let's say you just pick a random set. Let's say you pick 2. And then you pick some other set that's strongly separated from 2. So maybe you can pick 2, 3. I mean, 2, 3 is an interval, but it's not one of these intervals which are strongly separated from everything. Like 2, 3 is not separated from 1, 4, let's say. Okay, and you can keep going, so maybe you also add 3, and then at some point you get stuck. So if I take 2 to 3 and 3, then there is no more intervals to add. Yeah, I know that because I already did the same lecture on Friday, and today is Wednesday, which is long, so it's been a long time since then, but I do remember. And these are, you don't get any more sets that are strongly separated from all of these other than the intervals. Okay, and but the point is that W is maximal by inclusion. But you can still ask, is W maximal by size? So, because what I did was just randomly constructed this collection, just picking one by one. So maybe there is a clever way to, maybe you don't start with a 2, but you start with like 1, 3, and then you add extra, and then you get maybe 4 sets here instead of 3. Right? So in principle, this is a very dumb algorithm of constructing a maximal by size collection. It should not work in general, but it turns out to work. And that is called the purity phenomenon. It's called the purity phenomenon. So a proposition is that any maximal by inclusion, you have it here. Any maximal by inclusion, strongly separated collection is also, let's say strongly separated collection W is also maximal by size. Namely, it has size of W is given by n choose 2 plus n choose 1 plus n choose 0. So that's That's, I guess, the first part of the proposition. And it's called the purity phenomenon. It's called purity phenomenon because there is secretly there is a, if you know about like pure simplicial complexes, there is a notion of a simplicial complex, which is like a geometric object glued out of triangles and tetrahedra and etc. And it's called pure if every face is contained in a face of maximal dimension. In particular, you can form a simplicial complex whose vertices are sets and whose faces are strongly separated collections. Then this proposition becomes that this simplicial complex is pure of this dimension, n choose 2 plus n choose 1 plus n choose 0. Yeah. So for example, if I count the number of sets, so let's say I count, well, first of all, even let's return to the n equals 3 case. Right, so each collection has size 7, and now you can count n choose 2 plus n choose 1 plus n choose 0. Right, well, n is equal to 3, so I get 3 choose 2 plus 3 choose 1 plus 3 choose 0. That's 3 plus 1, which is 7. So yeah, 7 is equal to 7, which is great. So in particular, yeah, the proposition just works in the case n equals to 3. And if you try n equals to 4, then there is first of all you count the intervals. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You get 8 intervals. Plus you also get plus 3 sets. Right? So the size of W is 11, while on the other hand, 4 choose 2 plus 4 choose 1 plus 4 choose 0 is what? It's 6 plus 4 plus 1, so that's also 11. So the conclusion is that even though I constructed this W in the dumbest possible way, turns out that what I got is a not only it has the maximal possible size. So W is also maximal by size. So yeah, the answer to this question is yes. Okay. Now let me tell the second part of the proposition. The second part is even better than the first one, I would say. Second part is that W is also maximal by size and consists of face labels of some wiring diagram. Okay, so now let me try to draw. So let's say I take this example. Intervals plus these three sets. And what are, well, first of all, what are the intervals? The intervals are these. You start taking initial intervals and then you kind of remove 1, 1, 2, and 1, 2, 3. So I can draw them. Yeah, I can draw them like this. So I can draw an empty set and then 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, and 4. So I'm trying to construct a wiring diagram. So remember, we have studied wiring diagrams before. So the blue things are going to be the face labels, so they're going to be the faces are the complements of the wires. So you start, you put your endpoints of the wires are labeled 1, 2, 3, 4. This is where your wires are going to start. And this is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4. That's where the wires are going to terminate. And the label of every face is going to be the set of wires which are below that face. So, and now, okay, now I can just look into my previous lecture notes and guess the wiring diagram. The wiring diagram is going to look like this. Okay, three goes to three, and then two goes to two. Right, let me try to label the faces. So this face here, it's only wire below it is two, so you label it by two. And for the other wire, you label it by three. And finally, this region is, you have both two and three below it, so it's labeled by two, three. So you get exactly a wiring diagram. And conversely, any wiring diagram is going to give you a maximal by inclusion or by size strongly separated collection. So yeah, that's great. And let me also, while I'm here, let me describe the dual object of wiring diagrams, which is somehow more geometric. So this picture is mostly topological, right? I'm considering the wires up to continuous deformations. But now let me instead make it into a rigid object. So here's what I'm gonna do. Let's say I choose, and that is called rhombus tilings. So what I do is I start with n vectors, n vectors which are cyclically ordered. So let's say here is my origin, and then my vectors are going to be 1, 2, 3, and maybe 4, something like this. So you start with n vectors which are cyclically ordered. And then you form a two n-gon whose sides are given by these vectors in cyclic order. So you start at some point, and then you put one, and then two, and then three, four, or you can go the other way around. You can go four, three, two, one. So you get a centrally symmetric 2n-gon. And then I'm going to label the vertices by sets. Right, whenever you have two vertices which differ by a vector, let's say 2, then you just add 2 to the label. So you start with the label of a vertex by empty set, and then you go 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. And similarly, if you go in the other direction, it's going to be 4, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4. So these are the vertex labels of your zonotopal tiling, rhombus tiling. And what is actually a rhombus tiling? Well, it's a tiling of this polygon by rhombi. So, and what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to try to guess a rhombus tiling with such vertex labels. So yeah, if I have 2 and 3, then I'm going to have to add points labeled by 2 and by 3 to my tiling. So let me try to do that. So I draw 2 and 3. And yeah, so here's how the picture is going to look like. Yeah. So this is labeled by 2, this is labeled by 3, and this is labeled by 2, 3. And that's right. So a rhombus tiling is a tiling of a polygon by rhombi whose sides are parallel to the sides of the polygon. So yeah, something like this. And yeah, now let me try to relate this to wiring diagrams. which I can, so I'm gonna rotate the picture slightly so that it's better. Yeah, I want to say that the rhombus tilings are dual to wiring diagrams. So let me try to draw a wiring diagram in red. And what you do is whenever you have a rhombus, well, it's not technically it's not rhombi, it's parallelograms, but you can kind of rescale things so that all the line segments have length one, and then these become rhombi. Okay, so whenever you have a rhombus like this, you connect the midpoints of the opposite sides by line segments, and you do this for all rhombi, and what you get is these red lines are going to be the wires in your wiring diagram. So I start at the boundary, let's say, and then so I just connect the midpoints of the opposite sides of the. So I go like this, and then like this. Like this, and finally like this. Okay, and the only thing left to do is just kind of extend these endpoints of wires to the sides. Then what you see is that topologically the red wires here are the same as the black wires here. And that's true in general. So whenever you have a wiring diagram, the planar dual of that picture is going to be some rhombus tiling, which you can recover by you take any such vectors, and then you look at the face labels, and then you take the corresponding points. So yeah, the whole correspondence is very easy. It's just planar, literally taking planar duals. Yeah. And in particular, even though I started with completely geometric notion of strong separation, I have arrived at basically recovering exactly rhombus tilings or exactly wiring diagrams. Like these are literally in bijection with maximal strongly separated collections. Okay, and yeah, so this was shown in this paper by Leclerc and Zelinsky in 98, which, by the way, so 98 is a long time ago. There was no cluster algebras in 98, and no, well, I mean, there was combinatorics, but in pretty early state. But anyways, they came up with this notion of strong separation from studying these quasi-commutant quantum Plucker coordinates. And they also came up with the notion of weak separation. So what is weak separation? Just by definition, two sets. Well, let me even copy. I'm just going to copy the notion of the definition of strong separation. And then I'm going to modify it a little bit. Yeah, let's get rid of this. Okay, so here's the definition of strong separation. And what I'm going to do is first of all, instead of strongly separated, I'm going to write weakly separated. Second of all, instead of taking sets of arbitrary sizes, I'm going to restrict to sets of a given size. So bracket n, choose k. Well, actually, I mean, the same definition is going to work for arbitrary sizes, but all right. So, previously I had ABC, now I'm going to add now I'm going to have ABCD. ABC less than D less than or equal to N, such that AC belongs to I minus J and B comma D. BD belong to J minus I, or vice versa. That's the definition of weak separation. And so if strong separation was kind of I minus j and j minus I being separated on a line, here they are going to be separated on a circle. So let's say I draw a circle with numbers 1, 2, 3, all the way up to n. And then let's say I draw I minus j, which looks maybe something like this. That's I minus j, and j minus I maybe looks something like this. I don't know, j minus I. So they have to be separated by a chord, which does not necessarily. So if the chord passes through this point between n and 1, then they're going to be strongly separated. But if it's an arbitrary chord, then they're weakly separated, which is a weaker notion. So that's great. And yeah, so now for now I'm going to, well, all right, let me change the let me say that the same definition applies to sets of arbitrary size, but for now I'm going to restrict to the case where they have the same size of just equal to k. So I'm looking, in other words, I'm looking for, I want to study, so W is now a weakly separated collection inside bracket n, choose k. And I'm going to ask the same question, like, is it true that any maximal by size is also, any maximal by inclusion is also maximal by size? And what are the combinatorial objects that these correspond to? So let's try an example. Let's say, so for an example, I have to choose two numbers, n and k. So let's say the smallest non-trivial example is where k is equal to 2 and n is equal to 4. Which is where, right, I mean, I have four indices here, A, B, C, D. So n has to be at least 4 in order for anything interesting to have, for any two sets to be not weakly separated. And so the only two sets which are not weakly separated in this case is I is 1, 3, and j is 2, 4. And these two are not weakly separated. Okay, and the other sets are cyclic intervals. Cyclic intervals are weakly separated from everything, right? In this case, these are 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, and 4, 1. These are weakly separated from everything. Okay, so in this case, there is two maximal by inclusion weakly separated collections. Maximal by inclusion, or also by size, weakly separated collections, they look like this. You take the intervals, and then you can add either 1, 3, or you can add 2, 4. Right. These are the only two possible options. And they all have the same size, which is, they're all of size 5, which is great. So this was the conjecture, which was, conjecture which was also made in this paper by Leclerc and Zlominski. And the conjecture is asking you whether every maximal by inclusion. By inclusion, weakly separated collection W inside bracket N choose K has is also maximal by size. Right? Is also maximal by size. Namely, it has size k times n minus k plus 1, which is a number that is familiar to us. Okay, so that was the conjecture, and well, I guess now I have to tell you a theorem, right, which is, again, let me emphasize that this conjecture was made when there was no playback graphs. There was, they just came up with this notion, also motivated from studies on quantum minors. And they just by experimentation noticed that any maximal by inclusion has the same size. And in particular, they had no combinatorial objects to try to attach to this data. So now, now I guess I'm gonna just go back and turn to my pre-recorded lecture that did not get corrupted, resolved, right? It was resolved, it was confirmed by Oh, Posnikov and Speyer. So theorem, which is due to Oh, Posnikov and Speyer in 2015, is that this is true. So let me copy. This is true, and there is more to this statement. Okay, so this is true, and well, what instead of having rhombus tilings of a polygon, what you have is NW, as you already probably expect. W is the collection of face labels of a reduced playback graph G with strand permutation FG equal to FKN, so for the top cell. Right, so maybe I should show you an example or something. Maybe let's say K equals to 3, N equals to 6, then the size of W is going to be equal to 3 times 3 plus 1, which is 10. And now if I open the applet again and I press 6 choose 3, then I see 6 boundary sets and 4 interior sets. So indeed that's 10 sets. Wait, what? Yeah. Is 10 the right? Yeah, 10 is the right number. Yeah, and you can check that these sets are, okay, so what are the interior sets? 3, 4, 6, 2, 4, 6, 2, 5, 6. 3, 4, 6, 2, 4, 6, 2, 5, 6, and the other one was 2, 3, 6. 2, 3, 6 plus intervals is 1 maximal by inclusion and by size weakly separated collection. I mean, it may look to you like I'm kind of, you know, preparing you, I'm creating the conjecture just to then state the theorem that the playback graphs are the answer to that conjecture. But it was completely backwards. There was a conjecture without any playback graph. And then playback graphs just turn out to answer this question. Yeah, so that's it. And I guess there is, okay, I have some time. So let me also mention there is a, well, first of all, there is a related result, which was also proven in the same paper. So let me copy this theorem. So there is an extension to arbitrary positroids. So let me even let's say I fix, so let F be a bounded affine permutation. Then any maximal by inclusion weakly separate collection W inside, well, instead of taking n bracket n choose k, I'm only going to restrict to the positroid. And then I also have to ask that the W containing the Grassmann necklace of F has size, and the size they're all going to have the same size, which is going to be the dimension of the positroid cell plus one. Sorry, the positroid cell of F. And W is a collection of paper graph, yeah, with the strand permutation just equal to F. So yeah, just literally, if you take any reduced Liouville graph, then its collection of faces is characterized by the following properties. So it has to be inside the positroid, it has to contain the Grassmann necklace, which is on the boundary, and that's it. And then it has to be maximal by inclusion. If it's maximal by inclusion, then it has the prescribed size, which is the number of faces of any reduced Liouville graph. And yeah, so that's the extension to positroids. Yeah. So yeah, there is one more. I still have time. Okay, there is one more paper, which is actually there is one more even question you can ask. Question: what about weakly separated collections of arbitrary size inside 2 to the brackets n, right? So far I have restricted to things of size k, right? Like here, for example, in the positroid has all sets of the same size. But what if I instead consider 2 to the brackets n? And that question turned out to have been overlooked by, yeah, Leclerc and Zelenski had some different notion of weak separation for such sets. So the one I defined is, anyway, never mind. What I defined is going to be correct for what I'm going to say next, which is that, this is the extension to positroids. Yeah, so here's another statement, which so any maximal by inclusion weakly separated collection W inside 2 to the brackets n has size n choose 3 plus n choose 2 plus n choose 1 plus n choose 0. So for example, again, what would be an example? An example would be, let's say if n is equal to 4, then again, only 1, 3, and 2, 4 are not weakly separated out of all the possible sets. So how many sets do we have? Well, it's 2 to the 4th, which is 16 sets total. And the maximal by inclusion weakly separated collections, they look like this. You take all sets without 1, 3, or all sets without 2, 4. So that's the, well, I guess I have to put double brackets here. So the point is that the size of any such W is the same and is equal to 15, which is again 4 choose 3 plus 4 choose 2 plus 4 choose 1 plus 4 choose 0. 4 plus 6 plus 4 plus 1. That's 15. Yeah. So this theorem actually, yeah. First of all, it was proved by me, and the kind of the second part is that it has the prescribed size and is the collection of vertex labels of a Zanotopol tiling. Zanotopol tiling of a three-dimensional cyclic polytope, which I have not defined any of these words. But so what you should think about this statement as a generalization of the, as a three-dimensional generalization of the two-dimensional statement above. So what did I have above? Above I had a picture that looks like this. Right, so I called it a rhombus tiling. So the tile, each tile is a parallelogram. Each tile just kind of looks like this. And then you start at the origin, and then you label as you keep going, you increase the sets of the vertex labels. But so that's the rhombus tiling is a two-dimensional Zanotopol tiling. So in 3D, each tile is gonna look like a cube. So hopefully I can draw this. Let me just draw a cube as usual. And you should think of it as somehow directed in this direction. So it's here the face labels are like S, SA, SB, and SAB. And here there are going to be S, SA, SB, SC, SBC, S, AC, and SAB, and SABC. So you want to consider tiles of some three-dimensional polytope by cubes like this. Well, they don't have to be actually straight cubes. They can be like parallelotopes somehow, slightly. Anyway, let me show you a picture of how that's gonna look like. I think I have a picture. Right. Yeah. So here's the GIF. Here are the two, on the left and on the right. You have two possible Zanotopol tilings of some three-dimensional polytope by these little cubes. And you see that the one on the left has 1, 3 in the middle, and the other one has 2, 4 in the middle. Right? And at the bottom you have the empty set, on top you have the whole set, and in the middle whenever you go along the vector. Anyways, if you look at all the parallel edges, they all add like 4 to your set. So yeah, that's the claim. And the hopefully I have some picture. Okay, yeah, I have a picture like this. So the point is that if you draw all possible, let's say, parallel edges like this, then you see that whenever you do that, you add 3 to your set. Here's another one. You always add 3 to the vertex label. So it's literally a three-dimensional generalization. And if you instead consider, so if you assume that all your vectors lie in the same plane, and you consider horizontal sections of this picture by different planes, right, that corresponds to restricting to the sets of size k, then what you're going to see are literally going to be the Playbig graphs. Right? So every tile, if you draw the sections of your tile, you're going to see two triangles. And if you just color the bottom one white and the top one black, then what you're going to see at each horizontal section are these Plavy graphs. So somehow what I want to say is that Plavy graphs arise naturally geometrically. If you just want to consider kind of three-dimensional rhombus tilings and then just take the horizontal sections, you get literally all reduced Plavy graphs for all top cells. And then they have to somehow be compatible with each other. So yeah, I think that is it for today. Have a nice weekend, and I will see you all on Wednesday, where I will promise to come back to cluster algebras.